Well, I'd like to say good morning to each one of you again. And we are thankful to be here today. God is certainly good, and we have much to be thankful for. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 13. We read these words. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was likened to a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and seat and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? On March the 13th, the 266th papacy, that of Pope Francis, began. He is known as the former Cardinal Jorge Mario Bergoglio. He was the Archbishop of Buenos Aires, Argentina. He began his study for the priesthood at the age of 21 and entered what we call the Society of Jesus or the Jesuits in 1958. He was ordained as a priest in 1969, 11 and a half years later. I think it takes a long time to become a lawyer. It takes a long time to become a doctor. It takes longer to become a Jesuit priest. This is the Jesuit way. They are extremely thoroughly trained. He is the first ever Jesuit to become Pope. Now, according to another Jesuit, Father James Martin, and I use that term simply to identify him, we learn the following, and I will refer you to the next slide in the presentation. It says, first, most cardinals come from the ranks of the diocesan clergy. That is, most study in diocesan seminaries and are trained to work in the more familiar Catholic setting of parishes, celebrating masses, baptizing children, presiding at marriages, and working closely with families in their parish. Their lives are perhaps more easily understood by the public at large. They begin as parish priests and later are appointed bishops and archbishops and later are named cardinals by the Pope. Members of religious orders, like the Franciscans, Dominicans, and Jesuits, live a different life. We take vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience and live in communities with one another. By contrast, parish priests receive salaries. We are also not as focused on parish life. In this country, for example, the Jesuits are known mainly for their educational institutions, middle schools, high schools, and colleges and universities like Boston College, Georgetown, Fordham, and all the schools named Loyola. So our lives are different from those of the diocesan clergy, not better or worse, just different. So members of religious orders may seem more unfamiliar to cardinals. Thus, not many popes in recent history have been from the religious orders. When choosing a leader, then, the cardinals naturally prefer someone from their world. Martin also noted, in the early 1980s, and this is an interesting statement, because of the tensions between the Jesuits and the Vatican, Pope John Paul II intervened in our internal governance. After a stroke failed our superior general, the Pope appointed his own representative as our leader rather than allowing the normal procedure, which was for us to elect a successor. I'm going to stop and just quote right there. The person who is called the superior general of the Jesuits is known in some circles as the Black Pope. And it is said that he is the one who really rules the roost in the Vatican, but the fact is that John Paul II clipped their wings and said, you're not going to rule, I'm going to rule, and he took over. And he shut the Jesuits down, basically, as far as trying to run the Vatican, because he appointed this person to be the, quote, Black Pope. And he says that this created tension among us. But then he goes on and he continues, that was his right as Pope, but it still discouraged many Jesuits. A few years later, we elected a new superior general, and the warm relations were restored. Still, the cloud persisted in some quarters of the Vatican, which meant that a Jesuit pope was too far-fetched to even imagine. What does it mean to have a Jesuit pope? He says several things. First, the new vicar of Christ is thoroughly steeped in the spirituality of St. Ignatius Loyola, who founded the Jesuits in 1540. Pope Francis has twice in his life, as all fully formed Jesuits do, participated in spiritual exercises, the month-long silent retreat that focuses on the life of Jesus Christ. The exercises call on you to use your imagination to enter into the life of Jesus in prayer. So Pope Francis, we can assume, is an intensely spiritual man who has plumbed the depths of the life of Christ in a particularly Jesuit way. Since his election Wednesday, we've heard at least a dozen Jesuits say, well, I don't know much about him, but I know he made the exercises, and we'll talk more on those later. Second, Jesuit training is extremely long. Pope Francis entered the Jesuit novitiate in 1958 at the age of 22 and was not ordained until 1969. That's about the average length of time for training for a Jesuit priest. And we'll look more on that Jesuit connection later. And that's from Father James Martin, and that was from a CNN religious blog where that was taken from. Now, as noted, Francis is the first pope that is a Jesuit. He is also the first pope from the southern, from South America and also the Western Hemisphere. He is the first to use the name Francis. He is the first pope to ask people to pray for him before he prayed and blessed them, supposedly. As Cardinal Bergoglio clashed, as he was Cardinal Bergoglio, he clashed with the Argentinian president, Cristina Fernandez de Kirchner, over proposed laws about allowing gay marriages and the free distribution of contraceptions. Pope Francis is considered by many a straight shooter who calls things as he sees them, and he follows the church's conservative wing. He was appointed by Pope John Paul II to be a cardinal, and his current position on abortion, his positions on abortion, contraception, men-only priesthood, and no gay marriage aligns him with John Paul II and Benedict XVI. Though some seem to be inclined to believe that he could and may indeed tackle the issue of contraception because of his supposed compassion for the poor and the problems that that doctrine causes. Also, like John Paul II and Ratzinger, Bergoglio has denounced liberation theology. By now, I'm sure you've heard that he uses public transportation, at least he used to, cooked his own meals. We certainly cannot fault him for that, nor should we. Francis took the name from St. Francis of Assisi, who was noted for his work among the poor, as well as, interestingly, being the first to produce a nativity scene. I wonder where those came from. Pope Francis is said to be, in fact, an extremely compassionate person toward the poor, and certainly we cannot fault anyone for that. So is it possible that we have actually attained a good pope? Someone who will turn the papacy around. Someone Protestants should hold out an olive branch to at this time. No, no, no. No, never will the papacy change. This will not happen, beloved. The fundamental points that make the papacy the man of sin are all fully supported and advocated by Bergoglio. One of the chief characteristics of God is that he doesn't change. In Malachi chapter 3 and verse 6, he says, I am the Lord. I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not concerned because of God's compassion. But he says, I change not. In James chapter 1 and verse 17, it says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is what? No variableness, neither shadow turning. So our God doesn't change, does he? But you know, there's one interesting characteristic of God that Satan to a degree shares, and that is that Satan in principle doesn't change either. He is so set in his sin, friends, that he's not going to change. And in his methods and in his plans, he changes the outside, he changes the veneer, friends, but in reality, he does not change either. We have a statement from the Great Controversy, page 50. And it says, this compromise between paganism and Christianity resulted in the development of the man of sin, foretold in prophecy as opposing and exalting himself above God. That gigantic system of false religion is a masterpiece of Satan's power, a monument of his efforts to seat himself upon the throne to rule the earth according to his will. Friends, the papacy is a masterpiece of Satan. It's a monument. You know, you don't move and take away monuments, do you? It's a monument of his efforts to seat himself upon the throne of God. She says also in this same book on page 581, and let it be remembered that it is the boast of Rome that she never changes. The principles of Gregory VII and Innocent III are still the principles of the Roman Catholic Church. And if you've done any of the study about Gregory and Innocent, they were people who worked to have great political power. Not just religious power, but political power. And so that's the specific principle she's talking about, too, is a power that claims to be religious, but is seeking political power, seeking political dominance. She says in the Review and Herald, June 1, 1886, Rome never changes. She claims infallibility, and after all, friends, if you have infallibility, how can you change? Because you've already got it. You know, to claim to then change is a claim that our infallibility isn't valid. And so they cannot change. Rome never changes. Her principles have not altered in the least. Now, the facade, the shell, the outwardness can change. Things can appear different. But the principles do not change in the least. She has not lessened the breach between herself and Protestants. They have done all the advancing. But what does this argue for the Protestantism of this day? It is the rejection of Bible truth which makes men approach to infidelity. It is a backsliding church that lessens the distance between itself and the papacy. Now, what we're looking at here today, friends, is a reflection of what this papacy means in the light of inspiration. Not just what people say, but in the light of inspiration. And I've read to you, friends, quotations from a book that were given under inspiration. If there was ever a book outside the Bible that was ever inspired, it's a book great conference.
Amen.
On two different instances, Ellen White had specific visions concerning these matters to write out. And she was guided and directed by an angel as she was writing these things. On page 50 again. To secure worldly gains and honors, the church was led to seek the favor and support of the great men of earth, and having thus rejected Christ, she was induced to yield allegiance to who? To the representative of Satan, the Bishop of Rome. The Great Controversy, page 50. She says that this Bishop of Rome is a personal representative of Satan. She also says in Manuscript Releases, volume 5, page 102, the Pope is not regarded by God as anything more than a man who is acting out in our world the character of the man of sin, representing in his claims that power and authority which Satan claimed in the heavenly courts. Friends, the papacy is simply an extension of the rebellion that began in heaven.
Amen.
And I want to tell you, when Satan was first in heaven, he didn't come out at God with atomic weapons and spears and swords and knives, guns or whatever. He came across very gently, very subtly. I'm just working for the building of the kingdom of God. And he told the other angels, you know, we just have to fix things. He didn't come out in a frontal attack at all. Now, as I mentioned a few weeks ago, when Benedict resigned, that there have been, within Adventism, some prophetic declarations concerning how some of the prophecies, particularly in Revelation 17, would be fulfilled. And we mentioned, for instance, Robert Hauser's book. Give glory to him. We mentioned the website, World's Last Chance, and how they were predicting that this next pope, after Benedict, would be John Paul II resurrected. Well, that hasn't happened. But I don't believe that this particular pope has any more or less prophetic significance, according to the book of Revelation, than any of the other popes do. But friends, we are at the end of time. Now, there are things that we need to watch and need to understand, and because these principles of the papacy are still intact, and they are supported by Bergoglio as much as they were by John Paul II or Benedict or any other popes before them. This particular pope, by some people, you know, the way they took the cross, we have a very specific fulfillment. I remember shortly after I became a Christian and President Jimmy Carter had been elected president, John Paul II had ascended to the papacy. And because Carter had a sister that was an evangelical Pentecostal and sort of wild out, I had one Sunday at a speech for him. He says, it's this president and this pope, and you can bet on it. It's going to happen because all the ties that need to be there are there. And you know what? That was 30-some years ago. It hasn't happened. But we are at the end. And we believe that we are very close to the end. But we're also talking about the fact that there are some people who believe that this particular pope has certain religious significance. We mentioned, as an example, the pope that would be elected this time was supposed to have a certain prophetic significance. The World's Last Chance website was saying that it would be John Paul II resurrected, actually a demon impersonating John Paul II in resurrected form. There were those who were saying that the prophecy of St. Malachy would be fulfilled, that this would be the Roman Peter, Peter of Rome. And in fact, it wasn't just a day or two after Francis was elected pope that I got emails saying that his real name wasn't Jorge, it was really Peter. He had changed his name somewhere down the line. The name that was given in the email is the name you see here that Francis of Assisi was born under. And this was the name that they said that he had. But actually what they found was someone found the name of the original Francis. This pope was named after him, and they applied it to him. But there really seems to be no evidence that this pope was born anything other than Jorge Mario, and that he has not changed his name. But, you know, we take things and we twist them and we try to make them fit our little prophetic scheme. And then we get something good and we run with it, we send it on, and we send it on, and we send it on. You know, we hit that little forward button. And friends, this is wrong. It's hearsay. It's wrong. We have enough that's documented. We have enough that's documented. And I'm going to read you more that's documented, that we don't need to go on hearsay. But the fundamental principles that make the papacy, are fully supported by Pope Francis, I can assure you that. First of all, what about the issue of the Trinity? Do you think that he supports the Trinity? He most certainly does. But what does the Bible say? Let's just look at a text or two about some key points just to refresh our memories. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 6, Paul says, "But to us there is but one God, the Father." Now, the Catholics would say, and in fact, anyone who believes in Trinity would say this, or most anyone who uses the term Trinity, would say that they believe in one God, right? But how is that one God defined? That one God is defined as Father, Son, Holy Spirit, a unity of three co-eternal persons, just like in the Seventh-day Adventist Statement of Fundamental Beliefs. But that's not what the text says. It says that we believe in one God, the Father. The one God is not Father, Son, Holy Spirit. It is the Father and one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things and we by Him. And so the Bible doesn't teach that Jesus is the second person of the Trinity. It never uses that terminology. Inspiration never does. The Bible, on the contrary, says that He is the Son, the only begotten Son of the living God. Do you think that Pope Francis has any disagreement with Sunday sacredness? Not a bit, friends. Not a bit. But what does the Bible say? Exodus chapter 20. Right there in the heart of the Ten Commandments, we have the Sabbath commandment. Verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Which day? Seventh day, but the Catholic Church claims to have changed the solemnity from the seventh day to the first day. And I assure you that Bergoglio is quite fully in line with that. What about the immortal soul? Do you think he believes that the living know they shall die, but the dead know not anything? Oh, no, he doesn't believe that at all, because he prays to Mary, he prays to the saints. Because he thinks they know everything that's going on. But the Bible says the dead know not anything. The Bible says the soul that sinneth It shall die, Ezekiel 18:4. And so he is definitely in agreement with these biblical principles. What about transubstantiation? Why, Thursday afternoon, I had a chance through an internet feed to watch him perform a mass, or part of the mass, for the rest of the cardinals. They believe in transubstantiation. You believe it. Well, what about, and this is an important one, this really gets to the crux of a lot of it, because everything culminates almost in this one piece. What about the mediation of saints? Does he believe in the mediation of saints and Mary? He absolutely does. But I want to read to you what the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, in verse 5. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. Paul says, "For there is one God." And who is that one God according to Paul's writings? The Father. And by the way, is this simply the words of the Apostle Paul, or is this holy men of God's faith as they were moved by the Holy Spirit? "For there is one God, and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus." Jesus is that great mediator. And he can be that mediator because he is the Son of God. This one point God specifically focuses on in prophecy. He calls this organization the man of sin. 2 Thessalonians, just a page or two back in your Bible. Chapter 2. Verses 3 and 4, he says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God setteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." You know, the temple was a place of sacrifice, it was a place of worship, it was a place of mediation. And one of the central key features of the papacy, not only in her Trinitarian doctrine, but in all of her doctrines, they focus toward and help support this concept of a human priesthood. Of having a confession where we don't go to God directly through Christ, but we go to God through a priest, or through Mary, or through one of the saints. And the Bible specifically prophesies that this human priesthood with a confessional was to take away the continual or the daily priesthood of Jesus Christ. But in Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 25, speaking of Jesus, it says, "Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by Mary, by the Pope, by the priests, by the saints." No, none of them, but by him. Seeing he ever liveth. He ever liveth to make intercession for them. Not a pope, not a priest, not Mary. Friends, I want to tell you, this whole system of Catholic worship is an abomination to God.
Amen.
I'm not speaking about people. We'll talk about the people issue later. But this system of worship that has a personal representative of Satan as its head works on the same principles that Satan works upon. And it doesn't change either. Not at all. Instead of Jesus being a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, Hebrews 5:6, Jesus is never a priest for us. And so we must seek a human priest, Mary, and the dead saints to become our intercessors. But beloved, each one of us may come to God through Jesus Christ. For he is our mediator and the one in whom we may fully trust. He will not betray our secrets. He will not order penance. He will not fail us. And he does have power to forgive sin. In Mark chapter 2 and verse 10, Jesus told the onlookers in his day, "But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins." He certainly has power on earth to forgive sins. Now I'd like to talk to you about the Jesuits a little bit. Maybe from an angle you haven't heard a few things. Maybe. We'll see. What do we really know about the Jesuits? The Society of Jesus, or SJ, as they are usually called. It's a Catholic, now religious organization, as we noted earlier, founded in 1540 by Ignatius Loyola. Its members are called Jesuits, and sometimes they're known as God's Marines. The Jesuits were founded, again, by Ignatius Loyola, and members must be willing to accept orders anywhere in the world. They must be willing to live in extreme conditions. Jesuits work today mostly in the field of education, founding schools, colleges, universities, and seminaries. So they work in intellectual research. Ignatius developed what are called the spiritual exercises that use mental images. They are divided into four thematic weeks of variable length designed to be carried out over a period of 28 to 30 days. They were supposedly composed with the intention of helping the one taking the retreat to discern Jesus and his life, leading to a personal commitment to follow Christ. Though the underlying spiritual outlook is Catholic, these exercises are often formed today or done today by Protestants. Well, I should say Protestants, not Protestants. And they are even taught in some Seventh-day Adventist institutions. The spiritual exercise booklet was formally approved by Pope Paul III. The Jesuits became one of the most active agents in the Counter-Reformation, including introducing two methods of prophetic interpretation whose purpose was to remove the onus from the papacy for being the beast of Revelation 13. We discussed those methods a couple weeks ago, futurism by Rivera and preterism by Althusser. Perhaps you've heard the oath of the Jesuits, first published in 1883. How many have ever seen or read the oath of the Jesuits? Are you familiar with it a little bit? I mean, it's really made the rounds a lot. I'm going to read it. We might read part of it, but we'll begin at least in the next slide. Listen carefully. I want you to be careful now. Listen. I do further promise and declare that I will, when opportunity presents, make and wage relentless war secretly and openly against all heretics, Protestants, and Masons, as I am directed to do, to expurgate them from the face of the whole earth, and that I will spare neither age, sex, nor condition, and that I will hang, burn, waste, boil, flay, strangle, and bury alive these infamous heretics, rip up their stomachs and womb of their women, and crush their infants' head against the walls in order to annihilate their execrable race. That sounds pretty bad, doesn't it? Sounds pretty bad. The next slide. It continues. That when the same cannot be done openly, I will secretly use the poisonous cup, the strangulation cord, the still, the poniard, and the leaden bullet, regardless of the honor, rank, dignity, or authority of the persons, whatever may be their condition in life, either public or private, as I am at any time to be directed to do so by any agent of the Pope or Superior of the Brotherhood of the Holy Father of the Society of Jesus. And it goes on. We'll just skip some of the rest of it, but you can look it up later, get the slides, and read the rest of it. They will vote for Catholic people. They will support the Mother Church. They will swear their allegiance to the Pope. And at the end they say, all of which I do swear by the Blessed Trinity and Blessed Sacrament, which I am now to receive, to perform, and on part to keep this my oath. And where do we find this? Well, this is in the United States House Congressional Record of 1913. So it must be true, right? Maybe not. Maybe not. Why do I say that? Well, first of all, we need to understand how this oath, which is quoted many times in the Congressional Record, how it ended up in the Congressional Record. It goes back to a man by the name of Thomas S. Butler. He was a Republican congressman from the 7th District of Pennsylvania. In the 1912 election, he was running against a Eugene C. Bonniewell. And he won his seat. In fact, he had been in Congress at that time for about 16 years, and he stayed in Congress till 1928 and didn't leave till he died. So he was there for representing the 7th District of Pennsylvania for a long time. But what had happened was Mr. Bonwelly had filed an objection with the Speaker of the House asking that Mr. Butler not be seated to represent the district. His objections were investigated by House Committee on Elections, which reported for which prepared a report known as House Report 1523. That report was submitted to the House on February the 15th, 1913. And upon request of a Congressman, Olmsted was included in the congressional record. And here's what we need to know. The House report reproduced in its entirety Mr. Bonniewell's written statements of objection. Among other items, Mr. Bonniewell's objections included discussions of religious slander purported by supporters of Mr. Butler. And some of the things that these supposedly slanderers had said were that Mr. Bonniewell was Catholic and this Jesuit oath, and so it was submitted as part of the evidence of what the supporters of Butler were saying in a slanderous way against him. And in fact, it was something that Bonniewell objected to, this particular oath, and even Butler objected to it and said he didn't believe that that was true. But because it was part of what was said, being said, it was put into the record. Did you know that? Now, that doesn't make it true. It doesn't make it false. It doesn't make it that it's not the Jesuit. It just means that simply if we are quoting it from the congressional record, it's not a reliable source to prove it. That's the point I'm making. It doesn't prove it. The source isn't good enough. And it reminds me of the statement that went on the internet a while back about Cardinal Ratzinger that was made concerning his supposed statement on Matthew 28:19. Remember that statement about the Apostles' Creed? It says, the basic form of our Matthew 28:19 Trinitarian profession of faith took shape during the course of the 2nd and 3rd centuries in connection with the ceremony of baptism. So far as its place of origin is concerned, the text, Matthew 28:19, comes from the city of Rome. And that seems like a very strong statement, but it's true. As we noted, that when you read something in a book, newspaper, or magazine, you see a set of parentheses, you know that it is within the parentheses. What's within the parentheses was written by the author of the article. And so this statement made a lot of the emails and made a lot of the forwards. But it wasn't. It wasn't there, friends. It wasn't there. They should have been brackets, and they should have given the context. Because when you read the context of the book, and we bought the book so we could check it out, when you look at it, and you read on through, it says, the answers can only be found by looking at the concrete shape of Christian belief, and this we now need to consider using the so-called Apostles' Creed. And he goes on, and the next statement also, and you can find this in his book, Introduction to Christianity. We also printed an opus a little while back. And he's not talking about Matthew 28:19 and the Trinitarian point. He's talking about the Apostles' Creed. And so we want to get this guy down the road. We want to condemn him for what he hasn't written. And it may be that we're condemning the Jesuits for something they didn't say and quoting from the congressional record. It doesn't prove it's true. Now, we haven't proved it's not true. But you have to accept something something has to be proven first before you accept it, to be honest. Let me just bring up someone else maybe you've heard about. Have you ever heard of a man by the name of Alberto Riviera? Mm-hmm. He claimed to be a former Jesuit priest. Mm-hmm. And he worked with Jack Chick for several years, producing the Chick books and supposedly exposing the Jesuits. And there's a lot of questions about his authenticity and whether we should quote him or believe him or not. But I'm reminded of something, though. All this is found in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. Peter says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, wherein ye do well, that ye take heed, as unto light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. What I'm saying here now is, we don't have to go by rumors. We don't have to go by supposed documentation that cannot be verified. Because we have already, friends, in inspiration, something that's more sure. Because in the spirit of prophecy, we have information about the Jesuits. We have what God knew that we would need. And so I want to just share with you what inspiration says. Something that we don't have to worry about, whether it's hearsay or not. Okay, so let's go on. What inspiration's view of the Jesuits? That's what's important. And can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Here we go. This is from the book, The Great Controversy. Throughout Christendom, Protestantism was menaced by formidable foes. The first triumphs of the Reformation passed, Rome summons new forces hoping to accomplish its destruction. At this time, the Order of the Jesuits was created, the most cruel, unscrupulous, and powerful of all the champions of popery. Cut off from earthly ties and human interests, dead to the claims of natural affection, reason, and conscience, holy silence, they knew no rule, no tie, but that of their order, and no duty but to extend its power. The gospel of Christ has enabled its adherents to meet danger and endure suffering, undismayed by cold, hunger, toil, and poverty, to uphold the banner of truth in face of the rack, the dungeon, and the stake. To combat these forces, Jesuitism inspired its followers with a fanaticism that enabled them to endure like dangers and to oppose to the power of truth all the weapons of destruction. There was no crime too great for them to commit, no deception too base for them to practice, no disguise too difficult for them to assume. Vowed to perpetual poverty and humiliation, it was their studied aim to secure wealth and power, to be devoted to the overthrow of Protestantism and the reestablishment of the papal supremacy. Great Controversy, page 234. Friends, that really almost just tells it all, doesn't it? It really gives us the scope of what this organization is willing to do and how dedicated they are. And you know, it's the Jesuits from where we get the little phrase at the end, justifies the means. Going on, this isn't all inspiration, says there's more. When appearing as members of their order, they wore a garb of sanctity, visiting prisons and hospitals, ministering to the sick and the poor, professing to have renounced the world, and bearing the sacred name of Jesus, who went about doing good. But under this blameless exterior, the most criminal and deadly purposes were often concealed. It was a fundamental principle of the order that the end justifies the means. By this code, lying, theft, perjury, assassination were not only pardonable, but commendable when they served the interests of the church. Under various disguises, the Jesuits worked their way into offices of state, climbing up to be the counselors of kings and shaping the policy of nations. They became servants to act as spies upon their masters. They established colleges for the sons of princes and nobles and schools for the common people, and the children of Protestant parents were drawn into an observance of popish rites. All the outward pomp and display the Romish worship was able to bear to confuse the mind and dazzle and captivate the imagination, and thus the liberty for which the fathers had toiled and bled was betrayed by the sons. The Jesuits rapidly spread themselves over Europe, and wherever they went, there followed a revival of popery. Book Great Controversy, page 235. That should help us to understand something about this Jesuit order. Now, does that mean that all Jesuits are bad people, or they can't be changed? Writing about the great religious awakening that led to the Advent movement, Ellen White noted, in South America, in the midst of barbarism and priestcraft, Lacunza, a Spaniard and a Jesuit, found his way to the scriptures and thus received the truth of Christ's speedy return. Impelled to give the warning, yet desiring to escape the censures of Rome, he published his views under the assumed name of Rabbi Ben Ezra, representing himself as a converted Jew. Lacunza lived in the 18th century. In fact, he died in the year 1801. And so he was a Jesuit. And yet he began to preach that Jesus was coming soon based upon his study of prophecy. He found the scriptures. He found the Christ in the scriptures. So there are individual men who change, who make a change of position. But they're not the ones, friends, who can obtain the office of Pope. Now I want to conclude by just making a few statements. Exodus chapter 23 and verse 1. Thou shalt not raise a false report. Put not thine hand with the wicked to be an unrighteous witness. Every time, I'm speaking to every one of us here, friends, every time we hit that little forward button without knowing what we're saying, we have become an unrighteous witness and we have become a wicked person in that act. Don't think I'm not being anything but serious. I'm not kidding. I've got the forwards this week, and I bet some of you got the forwards this week. And maybe some of them are true, maybe they aren't, but we don't even know. I got a thing one day this week, and the source on it said, I don't know the source, I don't give the source something that affects it, but I just pass it on. Well, that's being a tellbearer. Friends, there's enough. In those statements I read to you from Great Conference, there's enough to indict the Jesuits. There's enough in inspiration, both in the Bible and Spirit of Prophecy, to indict the papacy, this man of sin. We don't need to make up things and become tellbearers and lose our own salvation trying to damn the papacy, trying to damn the devil. We will. Don't kid yourself. God's not going to overlook it. You don't want to overlook the sins of the papacy, and you say you won't overlook the sins of the papacy, but you want to overlook my sin or your sin. He's not going to do it. In Testimonies to Ministers, on page 65, speaking to those not willing to release their self-righteousness, she says, they are not willing to exchange their own righteousness, which is unrighteousness, for the righteousness of Christ, which is pure, unadulterated truth. Truth, not error, not a mingling of truth and error. We talk all this about the righteousness of Christ and sharing His righteousness. She says it's truth. And you want else? The Bible says it's truth too. It says, all thy commandments are righteousness, thy law is the truth. In Testimonies to the Church, volume 5, page 81. The time is not far distant when the test will come to every soul. The mark of the beast will be urged upon us. Those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be rather than subject themselves to derision, insult, threatened imprisonment, and death. If I may just stop there for just a minute. It's interesting that in this statement she doesn't mention doctrine. She doesn't say those who believe the false doctrine, the wine of Babylon. But rather, she says, those who have yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs. Think about that, friends. She goes on to say, the contest is between the commandments of God and the commandments of men. In this time, the gold will be separated from the dross in the church. True godliness will be clearly distinguished from the appearance and tinsel of it. Many a star that we have admired for its brilliancy will then go out in darkness. Chaff like a cloud will be borne away on the wind, even from the places where we see only floors of rich wheat. All who assume the ornaments of the sanctuary, but are not clothed with Christ's righteousness, will appear in the shame of their own nakedness. Testimonies for Church, volume 5, page 81. And so, beloved, it comes down to us today. Are we going to be the kind of people who will stand and speak the truth and speak no lies? Because 144,000, they have what? No God, friends. Are we going to be like that? Are we going to stand and speak the truth? This world is going to wonder after this beast power. The Bible says that. We've read that in Revelation 13:3 this morning. Are we going to wonder with it? Are we going to wonder with its doctrines? Are we going to wonder with its worldly conformity? In the 17th chapter of Revelation and the 18th chapter of Revelation, we find the downfall of the harlot and all those who associate with her, and the merchants of the world as well. Are we going to be in that group? Or are we going to come out? The Bible says we are to come out. To come out of Babylon, to come out of all this Babylon, not just simply her teachings, all the worldly conformity and everything that will in any way hinder us from running the Christian race. We need to come out, and we need to come out now. It's time, friends. It's time to sing, come out of her, my people. It really is.